All right, we are now back with the ruckus. We are joined by super middleweight Frank Galarza. How are you doing tonight, Frank?
I'm good, thank you. How are you doing?
I am great. I'm great, you know, here, happy to talk about some boxing on a Tuesday night. I'm also joined by my co-host, Ryan Bivens, who is based out of Philadelphia, just in case you guys have met or not met before. Ryan Bivens,
East
Frank
Coast.
Galarza.
East Coast, okay. East Coast.
What up, man?
Hello?
Ryan's a little yeah. under the weather, too, so he's popping in and out of the call, so he might be muting for some coughing.
Am I on?
Come on, Ryan. Come on, man. Drink some ginger. You'll be all right. Ginger tea, man.
Ginger. Ginger will make you good, or get you a ginger, you know?
About
you
never
know.
Oh, get you a ginger. Yeah, that works.
Yeah, that'll work, too. So, Frank, you know, we are... been watching your career. Tell us a little bit about your last outing in the ring, and then we'll talk about in the ring right now.
Well, my last fight, it was I had fun, man. It was just something that I just, you know, it was just, you know, I felt them out. I do what I do best, man. I feel them out, and then I execute, and that was the goal. You know, we came, we had a job to do, and we got the job done.
Right, for those of our listeners who know your name but aren't as familiar with you, you know, talk a little bit about your fight style. How would you describe your fight style?
Well, I mean, I don't, like, people consider me like a boxer puncher. I think I would consider myself the same thing as a boxer puncher. I like to bang a little bit, though. I like to brawl inside, you know, just kind of stay in the pocket, you know. So, I don't know, it's my thing, man. Sometimes I get into the Mexican mode, which is, you know, it just brings the fight. It's more action-packed. It's more entertaining, and it gives fans what they want.
Right, right. Who are some of your favorite influences or boxers that have influenced the style in which you perform from the past?
Marvin Hagler is actually one of my biggest, like, I just love his style of boxing. You know, he could box. He was strong. He could punch. And, you know, when he needed to fight, man, he would fight. And he was, like, a real champion, a real warrior. And I think, you know, I really, like, kind of, like, try to image him in a way, but, you know, not really. But I just, like, I love Hagler as a fighter.
In the fights that you've had your most success in, what type of fighter would you say you found yourself most successful against? What style?
I don't know, man. I tend to, like, you know, it depends on my opponent. Honestly, I really, that's a tough question to ask. It really depends on my opponent. The quality of my opponent brings out the best of me, you know. So I'm like, I'm one of those guys that, you know, based off my the opposition, you know, I tend to, like, increase with my opposition. So, as you know, if my opposition is, like, better than me, I bring myself to that level where I get to, you know, that same level. And, you know, I put on a show, man.
Mm-hmm. We know that boxing starting to get really, really active. In 2015, we've seen a lot of fighters and promoters and entities making a variety of moves. I'm sure yourself is no exception. What's next for you? You know, when is your next fight?
Well, honestly, at this point, I'm unsure. You know, I'm just waiting for my manager to hear from, you know, the Bella Entertainment and just kind of let it go through the right channels and we take it from there, you know. But I'm still in preparation. I'm always training, so I just try to stay focused. I'm hungry.
Definitely, you know, definitely needed in the game because there's a lot of athletes out there that are kind of perpetrating these days. So, you know, it's always refreshing to see fighters come to the ring with that same hunger and intensity that leads to victory. Tell me a little bit about. I'm not going to call any names out, but we know fighters who are a little, you know, a little spoiled, a little entitled.
Yeah, man. It's boxing, though. Boxing's changed a lot, man. So it's one of those things where you kind of got to accept and kind of go with the flow. But it's just, like, it's difficult, man. It's difficult, you know. It's, like, it's rare that you get a real fighter who wants to fight and who wants to put on a show, especially for the fans, you know, for the people out there. And I think, you know, that's really what it's there for. You know, boxing, you go back to the old days of boxing, it was exciting, you know. It was something people wanted to see. Now we're competing with UFC. You know, it's just like, I don't know, man. It changed a lot, man.
Of the new developments in boxing, if you could change one thing about boxing as it is today, what would you change?
I would change. I mean, I can't say the business of boxing is always going to be the business of boxing. I would change. I honestly don't think I like the route that it's going now. I mean, I love the whole you know, the network thing, like NBC, and, you know, that where people can watch it on basic channel, Spike TV. You know, I thought those fights were actually really entertaining. Keith Thurman, you know, those guys, they put on shows. But what I would take away from it is the whole entrance thing, and I feel like it's like wrestling, man. WWF, you know, it's just whole, you know, it's just like it's for me. It feels scripted. It doesn't feel real and genuine. It just feels like it's just all, you know, everything is just a certain way. Like, you can't do this, you can't do that. It's like, that wasn't what boxing was about. Boxing was about entertaining the people. You know, it was entertaining the fans. It was just like putting on a show, and the way you put on a show is like, you know, you look at the ring entrances. For instance, Mayweather, when he came out with the Caesar, you know, the Roman outfit, the whole look, you know, that was entertainment, man. That was what boxing was about at times, you know, with the whole, it just, I don't know, man. It just very scripted now.
Mm-hmm. With so many eyes on fighters these days, and not in a positive method, with social media and everybody got a phone, has a camera, and want to be the first to report, you know, how do you feel, what do you think are the pros and cons of social media with boxing these days?
Well, I mean, obviously, you know, we just, with the media, it's good. The pros and with the social media is actually benefits, because, you know, you get to put yourself out there, you know, you're connected to the world, you know, it's worldwide. So as far as to expand on that, it's just like, you know, you could increase your fan base. You know, for me, I get messages from guys from New Zealand, and I'm like, really? You guys, you know, New Zealand, really? So I think that's the pros of it. The cons of it, I mean, the cons is basically, you know, you got to watch what you do with everyone filming, you know, cameras, phone, you know, video phones and all that stuff. It kind of puts you in a position where, like, you really need to secure your surroundings, the people you with. You know, how you act, you know, you want to be a professional, so you have to maintain a certain professionalism, you know, for the sport, especially, you know, kids nowadays are easily, you know, I'm a big fan of positive influence, so, you know, I'm more for the kids, so I want them to see something positive and something in a positive light than something negative. You know, I don't want to bring them to that place where it's like, you know, you have to be this kind of way, you know, you have to be ignorant or just, out of, you know, stand out of place just to cause a scene, because that's what people want now. They want you to cause a scene. They want you to be loud and rowdy. And it's just like, is it worth it, you know, for what? For a little bit, for 3 weeks of retweets, and then nobody even talks about it anymore. So you got to find the next niche, the next thing to speak. You know, it's not a reality show.
Mm-hmm. So how do you manage to walk the fine line between remaining entertaining but not doing so much that it receives negative attention? Like, how difficult is it for you to do that?
For me, it's not really difficult. I am who I am, you know, whether you like it or love it. At the end of the day, I'm a street kid, man. I'm a kid from the hood. They just put gloves on me. So it's like all they did was just put gloves on me. Now I get to fight for free, and, you know, I get to fight freely without it's my job. And I don't want to sound like, you know, in a way, like, you know, I am a street kid. So I'm a kid that comes from the hood, who comes from the ghetto, who know what it's like to live that life. So, I know both sides of the fence. And, you know, when they say, oh, the grass is green on the other side, you have to go on the other side, you know, or maintain your side of the grass to make it greener. So you just got to find the balance. And I got these kids that I got to influence, man. You know, I got my youth organization where it's just, I have to be a positive outlook where, like, you know, this is who I am. I'm always going to be me. But at the end of the day, I don't need to be arrogant and ignorant, you know, and just kind of, you know, talk out of my mind where, you know, people like, you know, is that really what they want? So I try to just, you know, maintain that, especially for the kids, man.
Exactly. You know, the children are so devoid of positive influence, so they need it in that at any opportunity and as many opportunities as they can get, especially young men who wander into boxing gyms. So it's definitely
needed. They see so much negative already. You know, they see so much negative already, negativity out there in the world. So it's like, why am I going to influence that? You know what I mean? Like, it's not even about that. It's about just doing what you love and just, you know, 10,000 hours, just put in the work, discipline yourself and put in that work, man, and any dream is possible.
Right. Exactly. You mentioned a little bit ago that you work with your promoter, Lou DiBella. What has it been like working with Lou DiBella?
I mean, I think DiBella's a great guy, honestly. You know, I've spoke to him personally. I've met, you know, like meeting him. You know, he's very, like, just down to earth, very chill. I mean, working with him, you know, they took my career. You know, they've done good by me. So, I can't really, and I just hope it continues to go that route. And, you know, I hope they just continue to put me in the best possible position. So I'm just like, you know, I'm grateful.
Absolutely. You know, veteran, long time in the game. So, you know, East Coast-based guy like yourself, I could see where you guys would have some things in common. You know, we see a lot of fighters these days, well, not a lot, damn near everybody, kind of gravitating to the Al Haymon model. And I'm sure as someone who's been on network TV and making your presence known, I'm sure you've been approached by it. What made you not go the Al Haymon route? Or have you signed with Al Haymon? Or are you going to sign with Al Haymon? What?
Nah, that's not even, you know, I'm not, you know, I've looked into it. You know, people spoke to me about it. You know, at this moment right now, you know, I have my promoters. You know, I work with DiBella, I work with New Legend. So it's just like, you know, I'm established with my promoters. You know, I don't see the need to really actually sign with Haymon. You know, I mean, I can understand someone who's basically, who doesn't have a promoter, who doesn't have anyone backing them, that they could go without Haymon, you know, because then it works out perfect for them. They could just fight, the fights are set up for them, and they just kind of do what they want. Plus, I kind of want to do my own thing, man. You know, like, I don't want to follow the wave. I'm going to be honest with you. Like, I really don't want to follow the wave. Everyone's going against the wave and doing all this stuff. I kind of want to do my own thing, man.
And there's nothing wrong with that. If you could envision, like, if you could map out your next three fights, how would you map it out?
My next three fights, how would I map it out? You're talking about as far as opponent-wise or
just, you know, what would be your ideal situation? You know, we look at the super middleweight division. Andre Ward has finally come out of
Wish I was a super middleweight. I hate to disappoint you right now, but I'm not a super middleweight. I'm a super welterweight, 154 pounder.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if you were... You know, I mean...
I'm a small guy. I'm a small guy, believe it or not. I look big on TV.
You just tell people, yeah, I look big on TV. I look bigger off TV. But, no, I understand that. You know, let me let Ryan jump in. I'm kind of monopolizing all of the conversation flow, so I'm going to let my co-host jump in and ask a few questions. Okay, Ryan. Uh-oh. Maybe my dog.
Hey, Frank.
Hey, what's going on, buddy?
Nice little knockout that you got over on Sheldon Moore.
How many technical knockouts I got overall?
No, I said nice left hook knockouts you got when you fought Sheldon.
Oh,
Moore.
All right.
That
thank
was
you.
Yeah,
I'm
that
sorry,
was nice.
Bro. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, man. You know, we have a. I think it's kind of the finisher. It's been the finisher twice on Showbox lately, so I don't know. You're trying to perfect that.
Yeah, you know, you've been having a good run lately. You know, ever since you got that upset over John Thompson. And, you know, Thompson's going on to do good things. He's got a boxing final coming up. How do you think he's going to do that?
Honestly, the kid is talented, man. I'm not even taking it away from the kid. The kid is talented. You know, I'm sure he'll do well. I hope he does well. You know, I know his opponent, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is the lefty, correct?
Brandon Adams, is he a southpaw? I'm not sure.
He might be the southpaw. That kid is tough, man. He's strong. And he comes to fight. So, I mean, like, as long as he's, you know, he's aware of his opponent, I'm sure that, you know, he'll do just fine, man.
Would you say that he's your best one in your career so far?
Yeah, I want to say he's been my best one, yeah.
You know, so far all your bouts have been scheduled for 8 or less. Are we looking at a title fight for 10 or 12 pretty soon?
Yeah, I was hoping. You know, we the last fight with Sheldon Moore, we told him that we wanted a 10-rounder, but apparently he didn't want a 10-rounder. So I'm hoping we start doing 10 and 12.
Do you know if you're rated by any of the organizations, WBC, WBA, IBF?
I don't know. I don't really. I don't think I really like take notice of that. I just focus on like fighting, man. That's my thing. Like I don't really know. I can be honest with you. I don't know. Maybe I should pay more attention to that, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. Fight your fight. Yeah, you tell them. Yeah, you gotta contact them. People say, "Yo, you got me rated such and such, man. I need a fight."
Or well, you know, you could come on this show. We like to troll the WBA relentlessly. So
yeah, we can't help you with WBA fights.
We can't stand
we can help WBA. You with WBC, IBF, WBA. We'll help you with those fights. But WBA, nah.
We will
nah.
help
but
you.
I have a WBC Latino, Latin American title. So I might be ranked with WBC. I'm not sure. I think it might have. Last time I heard something, I was like top 20, I think.
No, let me check right
Why
now.
Why you guys don't like WBA? I have to interview you guys now. Why you guys don't like WBA? I
okay,
don't care.
Because.
I could go to the WBA right now and tell them I need a belt, and they probably would give it to me if I came with my wife.
Well, I was about to go. I was like, well, maybe I should do that.
You know, I could go to the WBA right now and say, you know, I need a sanctioned fight for the Inglewood, California Super Middleweight Championship International Black Woman Belt.
Just make a belt for me for my community, all right? I want to fight in my hometown.
Exactly. Any sanctioning body that has a regular champion, a super champion, an interim champion, all in the same weight class, and who is the best of the weight class? If you can just
there
make
is,
up the innocuous belt for no reason.
That's actually the problem there too. You know, you got to really consider that because that's one of the big. That's one of the big issues now that, you know, people are just getting random belts now. It's like, all right, where's this guy world champion of? You know, what did he do to actually win this title? You know, so it's like, it's not boxing, man. I don't know. I love you, boxing. I love you, but Jesus.
Boxing is like the sexy girlfriend that's crazy as hell. You love her to death, but she crazy and don't want to act right.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
you still love
her. Yeah, you don't know what's
going
to happen next. You don't know what's going to happen next in boxing.
Exactly.
All right.
You know,
I looked you up.
Go ahead, Ryan.
I said I looked you up in the WBC rankings. You're rated number 29 by the WBC. And looking at the top 15, which those are guys are like in the world title and international title contention, Carson Jones is number 15. And I think that would be a very
Who?
Good fight for you. Carson Jones.
Who?
You know, because he's been on TV. People know him. So I think, like, you know, Showtime or whatever network here in the States would pick up a fight between you and him. Since he's rated 15, went over him, put you in the top 15.
There we go. We can start the Twitter campaign tonight. We call him tonight.
I don't even know Percy Jones, but whatever, I'll fight him.
We're going to get his Twitter. We're going to start
Carson
trolling
Jones
tonight. Why you dunking
a couple
Prince
of fights
Garza?
With
Kell
Brook at welterweight. The first fight he gave Brook all he could handle. He lost the majority of the decision. Next fight he got knocked out. Since then he's come back. He just went over to the UK again and upset Brian Rose with a first round knockout. So yeah, he's rated at 154 now. He's got a vacant WBC International Super Welterweight title.
There it is.
You know, he's like a journeyman type guy. You know, he just goes where the money is. Like, he retired not that long ago, but he came out the money. Came out of retirement, I guess, you know, they offered him some money. So, you know, if people throw some money at him, I'm sure he'll take the fight.
Frank, you got that.
You know what? Look, at this point, I don't even care, man. Like I said, I'm hungry, y'all.
You got that. That's a winnable fight for you right there. And it agrees
Ooh,
to your rank.
Kill him.
There you go. Well, Frank, before we wrap up with you and bring on our next guest, you know, if you can, listen to the show because it's about to get live. Our next guest got a lot to get off his chest. You know, tell the listeners where they can keep up with you on social media and support you and keep an eye on your career.
Man, that sounds intense. Your next interview sounds really intense. I wish you guys luck, honestly.
Thank you.
But they can always follow me on Notorious_FG on my Twitter page.
And my Instagram is BK underscore Rocky.
All right. That sounds great. Well, it's been a pleasure speaking with you. Any last words for the listeners before you take off?
I just want to thank you guys, man. I really appreciate you allowing me, you know, putting me on this. You know, it's it just means a lot. You know, at least I'm getting some recognition out there, and I really appreciate you guys. And I just want to thank my promoters, New Legend, Lou DiBella, and my management, man, Elite Boxing, AJ Galante, yo. You know, he's been, we've been working, man. We grinding. We here. We here. Don't sleep on me. Hashtag that.
Hashtag that. We here. We out here. All right, Frank, good luck. We're looking forward to seeing you in the ring very, very soon.
Yes, thank you, guys.
All right, take care.
Take care.